Hello. Hello. Good evening. Welcome and thank you for joining us. I'm Linda Cogswell. I'm an architectural associate with the city and the project manager for the 7th Street fencing upgrade and activation project on behalf of Big Blue Bus. Tonight, I'm joined by my colleagues, Amelia Feichner and Lizzie Acosta, as well as our design team, Ryan McKay, Jeremy Klemick, and Ying Yu Hung from SWA Group. So in this meeting, we'll be sharing with you the improvements that are planned as part of this project, as well as obtaining your input. We're excited to be delivering these new amenities to the downtown Santa Monica neighborhood, its residents, visitors, and employees. We're aiming to complete design by the end of the year and start construction in early 2022. So for this virtual meeting, we'll be using the chat and poll features to engage with you. So please feel free to enter any questions or comments that you have into the chat. Your messages will be seen by the city and consultant team. I also wanted to mention that the meeting is set up for 5 to 8 p.m., but we expect to wrap up the meeting by 6 or 6:15. So again, thank you for your interest. Thank you for accepting our invitation to participate. And with that, I will hand the presentation over to Ying Yu.
Hi, good evening. My name is Ying Yu Hong. I'm the principal in charge and also a landscape architect with SWA. So we're really, really excited to be invited and to collaborate and work as part of the design team with the City of Santa Monica. It's a very, very special project for us, given that it's got very interesting programs, such as the dog exercise area for different types of, dogs. And then there's also an outdoor seating area. So we love to kind of share our designs and thoughts with you and to get your feedback. So with that, I would like to hand it over to my associate principal, Jeremy Klemick, to begin the presentation, and then followed by Ryan McKay. All right, thank you.
Great, thank you, Ying Yu. So we can go ahead, and this index slide is going to give you a brief overview of what we'll be looking at throughout this presentation. First, we'll familiarize everyone with the site location, then we'll go into a brief project overview. We'll talk a little bit about the existing conditions of the site, and then we'll delve deeper into what the public picnic area will look like, and then the fun stuff with the dog exercise areas and shared mobility. And we'll come in also with the portion where there's some improvements to the Big Blue Bus's alighting area, as well as the fueling station that is down off of 5th and Olympic. We can go ahead and go to the next slide. There might be a little bit of delay on going to that next slide, seems like on my end. Excellent, here we are. So we are bordered on 4th Street, 7th Street, Colorado Avenue, and Olympic. And so the site location that you're looking at is highlighted in yellow. The long linear strip specifically between the sidewalk edge and the building storefront. We are not touching any public sidewalk or the parkway areas along 7th Street. And then we're also looking at the fueling station, which is located at the 5th Street and Olympic Boulevard. You can go to the next slide. So as a brief overview, along 7th Street, we are looking at bringing in 4 dog exercise areas, specifically one area for small dogs, one area for injured, or as we say, in training dogs, and 2 areas for large dogs. And we'll go into the sizes and requirements for each of those in a little bit. The public picnic area includes seating, tables and chairs, signage, and of course, trash. Our mobility space is for scooter parking or bike parking. The security improvements in the lighting area, Ryan will expound upon a little bit later in the presentation. And then there are some slight landscape improvements for these areas. Next. So the fueling station incorporates some security fencing, automatic vehicular gates, a pedestrian access gate, and signage. Next. Let Ryan kind of delve into a little bit about the site's existing conditions.
Oh, geez, there's a little bit of a transitional delay. Hello. So as you can see in the site plan, as Jared may mentioned, this project is broken up into four zones. And as we go through this presentation, we've kind of broken each of these into digestible pieces. And I want to go through some of the existing conditions that we found along 7th Street, as the majority of this presentation will be talking about Zone A and B, the public picnic area, as well as the dog exercise and mobility area, and then followed by Zone C, the lighting area or bus stop zone, as well as some security measures over at the fueling station off Olympic and 5th. So in this plan view, you can see the existing conditions along 7th Street. From the top left corner, you have Colorado, the corner of Colorado and 7th. And then in the bottom right, you have Olympic and 7th. And this is just a cut down the middle, but along the entire block of 7th. At the bottom of the screen in these plans is the Big Blue Bus maintenance yard. And as you can see by the thick dashed black line is the limit of work on this project. We have a very linear site, and our only scope is from back of sidewalk to face of building or walls. And is kind of bifurcated into different segments in which break down into those zones by existing driveways and building entries. As well as everything outside of the limit of work is to remain. This includes existing parkway planting, trees, utility poles, lighting, bus bays, and any of the sidewalk driveways, bollards, security measures. Always to remain and protect in place. And as you can see in the bottom middle plan, where the limit of work line juts out, there's the existing bus stop and chair, which will remain in place, as well as the entries into the building. So going on to see some site photos, we're standing at the corner of 7th and Colorado looking in at the site. And all of these site photos, we've highlighted the limit of work area, which again is from back of sidewalk to face of building. This is seen in the bright pink dashed line. As you can see in from the first and second image, you're looking at where we are gonna go into a little later, the zone A, the picnic area, taking this underutilized decomposed granite patch and turning it into a paved gathering space, you know, shade and table and trees, table and chairs. As you can see, the limit of work doesn't include any of the improvements to parkway and sidewalk, and all existing trees and utilities are to remain, as well as entries in at the building for the Big Blue Bus maintenance yard, security measures as of bollards and lighting and security cameras all are to remain. Moving further down 7th Street, you can see again, we're just renovating the planting area adjacent to sidewalk, and within these planting area exists some pretty large specimen plants as well as boulders, which are all to be salvaged and reused either on this project site or given over to public landscape to furnish into other public sites to use at their own discretion. Now, if you could see on the plan view on the left, where the bubble six is, that's where the bus stop existing is. The chair will remain, and then there are some additional security improvements that we'll get into later for what we're calling the lighting area or bus stop, where these existing concrete raised planters will be removed, as well as the old chain link fencing, and additional security will be added with a new fence to match the existing gates at this corner. On to zone A.
Yes, so I'd like to kind of jump back in now, and we'll talk a little bit about this zone A, which is the public picnic area, which is at the corner of, you can go to the next slide, that's fine, right? at the corner of Colorado and 7th there in that underutilized, as Ryan mentioned, decomposed granite area. So what we're really wanting to look at here is kind of how do we activate this space and how do we make it something that feels comfortable for the public, people either to come by and sit while they're walking their dogs or with no dogs, or just people coming out of the big blue bus or the apartments nearby. So in plan view here, what you're seeing is the addition of some movable tables and chairs, which will be out during certain hours of the day and maintained and brought back by the big blue bus staff. We're adding concrete pavers, which you'll see the patterning and a perspective in just a moment. And we're adding trees as well as umbrellas that you see here, and a little bit of landscaping to act as a buffer zone, kind of create a really nice space there. And I think it was mentioned earlier that we do have a couple of poles, which are going to be a lot of fun to see what everyone thinks about those. And one of the items we'll be looking at the end of this public picnic area portion of the presentation is furniture style. Go ahead and go to the next slide. So here you can see sort of a perspective, which we work very closely with Big Blue Bus as well as public landscape. And you can see there's a small little barrier buffer planting right up against the sidewalk edge, kind of to delineate the areas where people are relaxing and sitting, as opposed to thoroughfares towards the dog exercise area or coming on and off of the buses. We are adding some landscape hedging to soften the wall edge right back on the backhand side, as you can see there. There's a break in the hedge there, which will be access to the Big Blue Bus maintenance yard for them to move the tables and chairs in and out. And what we found with many movable tables and chairs is people like to kind of make the space their own. And so we will be looking towards the public to see sort of what feelings we want to have for those tables and chairs. And you'll be able to kind of, you know, if you want to have six people sitting around a table or two people, they will be mobile. Looking at the concrete pavers there, we can go ahead and go to the next page. Form materials. The existing plants to be salvaged, Ryan brought earlier, and those will be reutilized by public landscape in other areas. We'll be bringing in the Mexican sycamore tree, which is a nice native tree. It'll provide shade during the hot summer months in spring, and it'll allow for the space to feel more open as it is a deciduous tree during the winter and fall. Bring some color, and we all know in Southern California, getting fall color is one of the only ways we can change the seasons, and there's only so many plants that get that. We're looking at utilizing the cat's claw creeper vine and or the star jasmine vine throughout the project. The hedge would be made by the Carolina cherry laurel, and we have some small shrubs and ground covers, which you saw, to soften the landscape at the edge of the sidewalk. Next page. So paver-wise, we are looking at utilizing a diamond-shaped paver pattern that would be integrated with a caramel and a granada white color. So those would be spaced throughout to sort of give some ground level hardscape interest as well. The small planting barrier, about 18 inches tall, would kind of protect the edge of the planting as well as give a visual edge to the space. Bringing in some nice new trash receptacles as well as movable shades with the foldable umbrellas. And then, as I've mentioned, the movable tables and chairs. And so really, this is kind of our first portion of the project where we're kind of going to be looking to everybody here. This is going to be our first real test on how these poles work. We do have one more later in the project as well for the dog exercise areas. But here we're going to be looking at asking which style furniture is preferred for this space. And so obviously there are a variety of colors that can be utilized with each style, whether it is a metal slat furniture, whether it is a basket weave type wireframe chair, or whether we're looking at hard grade perforated metal. All of these are of course intended to be stackable and movable by either the public when they're out in the space, so you don't feel like you're locked into a specific spot, or whether it's being moved back in for maintenance purposes. So what we'd like to find out from you guys via this poll, which I believe Ryan will make public in just a moment, and we'll wait a few minutes as polling information comes in, is the preference for a metal slat, a wire frame, or perforated metal tables and chairs? And the poll went live. I just watched it happen. This is fun. Again, with each one of these, there's obviously different options color-wise, but we are looking at a vibrant color palette to be coming in, something that enlivens the space, something that people will feel comfortable sitting in.
I see polls are coming in. There are votes. We do have almost the majority of participants that have voted, but I'll keep it open for 20 more seconds.
If there are people out there that have an opinion on it, please, yeah, feel free to weigh in. That way we end up having a very clear-cut winner is always nice. But obviously, we like all three of these for this space. I feel all of them will work well.
And always, the event chat is open. So if you'd like to leave any additional comments or questions throughout the presentation, feel free to do so, and we'll address them at the end of the presentation. All right, we're at a minute 30. I'll go actually till 2 minutes. For those that might be catching up. I'll end the poll.
Sounds great. Well, that worked. Can't wait to see what the next one comes back with. We're going to move up to the dog exercise areas along 7th Street. So when we're looking at the dog exercise areas here, we are looking at the injured in dog training exercise area. Starts off as closest to the public picnic area, and part of the reason behind that is it can also be utilized for dog adoption days or just other things that tie in towards sort of a more public open space. Looking at a 42 inch tall fence, a limit of about 2 dogs, but there are no size restrictions. So when we talk about injured training dogs, you know, these are the dogs that are coming out, they've got the cone on, or they're utilizing wheelchair pieces, or really just kind of getting dogs that are kind of new towards experiencing other dogs around themselves. The small dog exercise area is, of course, a little bit larger. The dogs are smaller, but it's larger than the in dog training area. We're looking at limiting to about 25 pounds with 10 dogs. Again, a 42 inch tall fence. I'll show an amenities plan that comes after this for each of these areas as well. And we're looking at probably 2 to 3 agility pieces in the small dog exercise area, and 1 to 2 agility pieces in the injured or in dog training. And then as we go across from the big blue bus entrance areas, as we move, I guess, more towards the east, what we'd be looking at is the small shared mobility area with maybe 2 bike racks, 6 of them. So the ability to park 12 bikes or scooters in that space. Go ahead and go to the next slide. So moving on to the larger dogs. So that's a dog that is considered over 25 pounds, and both of these exercise areas would have a limit of about 5 dogs. Of course, we're looking at rules signs for each of them, concrete seat walls behind, 3 to 4 agility pieces in each one of these. And one of the items to really think about, you've seen the site constraints. So you'll see a small section in just a moment, which sort of describes the area of space. So we're really trying to maximize the usage of space as well as add entrances on both sides and still give interesting agility equipment and pieces for the dogs to really exercise in. And there's thoughts as a donor recognition area in between both of these where there may be some type of interesting paving on the ground or something that's going to happen in there that we're looking at, whether it's the dog paw print like you see there, but with a wall behind it that provides information for donor plaques in the etched concrete And the idea behind that is we've realized that people like to be able to give back, and this will not only help the maintenance of the park over time, but really help the public feel like they've played a part in this process by being the option to donate as well. I'll go ahead and go to the next slide. So this is a perspective looking at the injured in dog training area and the small dog area to really give you an idea of the feeling of the space that's being utilized in this. And we really feel that having a small buffer of little landscape plants, as well as some vines growing along the edge of the fence there, kind of buffer the dogs and the people that are walking back and forth down the sidewalk. There's capability for obviously rule signs to be put on these, as well as some type of cutout plaques or really interesting and colorful information put along the sides of these wire fences. Next. So this perspective kind of gives you a little bit of a feeling of a full large dog area where we've got five dogs in here, a couple German shepherds and some labs. And you can see people have the ability to sit along the concrete seat wall along the back. And the agility equipment shown in this photo is a little bit more just representative of how the pieces will fit into the space. As mentioned, that's where our next fun poll comes in. And that's going to be about the agility equipment pieces and what we're looking at for these spaces themselves. You may have noticed the color differentiation in each of these dog exercise areas, and that'll be achieved through a variety of decomposed granite. We're not looking at resilient surfacing. It's not rubberized. It's not concrete. And it's really a decomposed granite that has some slight tonal aspects to it, a little bit more to, as we said, bring some liveliness to it and create something that's a little different, a little more special for Santa Monica. Next slide. So here kind of gives you a feeling of a section through the site where we've got a 1 foot drainage channel up against the side of the building, continuing with the existing downspouts and allowing the site drainage to work so that we won't be doing very minimal to no impact sustainability wise on the site itself. We are looking at a retaining curb against that to kind of hold the drainage gravel in, and that allows us to actually be able to level out the slope against the sidewalk there, which you can see the existing slope dashed line. We'll have about 9 feet for the dog exercise area before it comes into the 1'6" planted buffer, which contains not only the fence, but also the vines and the landscape buffer up to the 6-foot public sidewalk, followed by the planted parkway, and then we're out into the street. Next slide. So materiality-wise, each of these dog exercise areas will have a dog waste station. Each will have a pet drinking fountain. Each will have a concrete seat wall. And then you've got some examples of the city standard bike rack, which you see at number 4 in the agility area. And then sort of an idea of what that donor recognition monument wall might look like with number 5. Next slide. So looking at kind of what the wire mesh fence with the vines will look like, this has been utilized successfully at other dog parks like the West Hollywood Dog Park. And it kind of really gives that buffer feeling where it's not really a kennel feeling and it's enclosed and safe. Large dogs can't jump over it, small dogs can't go through it. And really having a vine to buffer that edge and spacing those vines so that they don't really cover over or are taken care of with different type of metal cutouts. And you saw them colorfully represented in some of the earlier perspectives so that we can really enliven the area. Even if there's no dogs or anything in there, it still gives the feeling and lets everyone know what it is. And of course, we'll have custom signage designed for small dogs or large dogs. And I think that one dog might be a little bit larger than that person, a little bit out of perspective, but the teacup dog and the large dog, it makes it a little more fun. It doesn't always just have to be a rules sign. So we'll be looking into that as well. Next slide. So something we'd like to talk about, and maybe you can kind of mention this in the chat. This part isn't really a specific poll per se, but there are many different types of agility equipment that can be utilized out there. And whether it is a weave pole or a hurdle, jump rings, climbing platforms, boulders, balance beams, tunnels, We've all seen the canine agility courses that a lot of the dogs use, and whether or not there's specific pieces in there, you've noticed that we're looking at 1 to 2 for the injured in training, 3 to 4 pieces for the larger dogs. So we don't want to overload, but if there's specific things that you would like to see out there, definitely put that in the chat. Otherwise, you know, what we'll be looking for is kind of a variety in between the spaces. Everything's not going to get the exact same time. And so next slide. We have 3 different options, which is going to be this poll of the actual style of the equipment. The first style we'd like to consider for these spaces is more of the traditional style. And that's kind of looking at, you know, bright colors, sort of some of your standard agility course pieces, very thematic to what you would see in your standard kind of everyday dog park. Next slide. Another option that we'd like you to consider is possibly naturalistic, and that's really using more natural materials with maybe muted tones, kind of giving an implied play value. So it's not specifically saying this is a teeter-totter, but dogs can climb up on them, whether it's a boulder or a log or something that's made to look like a boulder or a log. Next slide. So the third part that we're looking at is something that's not overly utilized nowadays, but it is contemporary. And that means by utilizing contemporary furniture, whether it's landscape form type furniture, whether it's bike racks repurposed into a tunnel, whether it's concrete benches that have really nice shapes, or even concrete tubes put in. So it's really more unique shapes and materials, distinctive forms that are utilized in a different manner than one normally would see them in the landscape, repurposed as looking for dog exercise areas, really. So this is kind of where our next poll comes up, and we'd like to kind of get your opinions a little bit on what you'd like to see there. And that's whether you'd prefer to see traditional, naturalistic, or contemporary agility equipment within these spaces. And I think, again, we'll keep the poll open for just a little bit over 2 minutes.
Poll is live. We already have votes coming in.
Great. I think I need to do more of my Zoom calls with polls and things on the way through. Fun to watch the opinions come in.
Yeah, thank you for voting. Looks like we're right at minute 15, poll being open. I'll keep it open for till 2 minutes. Looks like majority have voted, but
so with the end of that poll, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and I'll turn it over to Ryan, where he's kind of going to enlighten a little bit about the alighting area, which is where people get on and off the bus, and kind of delve into a little bit about what the fueling station is going to look like at the end of this project as well. Go ahead, Ryan, it's stage is yours.
Thank you. Yeah, so as you can see from the site plan, talking about zone C and D, the lighting area or the bus stop area at the end of 7th over at Olympic, and then some security improvements and fencing over at the fueling station, Zone D off Olympic and 5th. So looking at the lighting area, as shown in the existing photos and conditions, we have the existing bus stop, which will remain in place, and a new real-time bus sign, a city standard for Big Blue Bus, will be installed here to provide, you know, real-time bus information to this stop, as well as security improvements and lighting at this bus stop. There's existing planter walls that will be removed and replaced with new concrete and fencing to match the existing gates that are into the Big Blue Bus parking area, and the existing furnishings of the trash receptacles and trees and planting pockets will still remain along the sidewalk. And then moving down Olympic to the corner of 5th and Olympic, as you can see in this existing site photo in the upper right-hand corner, it is a city-owned fueling station. Currently, it's open and allows, you know, unwanted pedestrians and vehicles to enter into the fueling site at all hours of the day. So a portion of this project's budget has been allotted to fence in the fuel pumps, providing entry gates, automatic entry gates off of entering in from Olympic and out onto 5th. The fencing will be accompanied by new planting and will be 7 foot tall to provide, you know, needed security measures as well as meet the standards of city, fire, police, school districts, and utility agencies that, you know, use this fuel pump daily.
And really, that's kind of the last slide on our presentation. We'd definitely love to hear any comments or questions from people who have been listening in. And if it's something you don't feel comfortable talking about right now, there's definitely a project website at www.santamonica.gov, 7th Street Project. And you can email Linda, who is on this call. Her email address is right there at the bottom. And my understanding is that this has been recorded and it will also be placed in a place where people can view it at a later date.
Well, unfortunately, on my end, I'm unable to see the chat, but I have heard that there are chats available. Linda or Lizzie on the line, are you able to see messages from attendees?
Voice that moderator chat, and we'll get those.
Linda, I can't hear you.
Oh,
sorry.
So I am seeing chats come in, but it just doesn't look like we're getting any you know, specific questions or comments. So if you are having trouble using the chat feature, just please email me at linda.cogsell@smgov.net, and I'll respond to you that way. And I just wanted to check, did we go over the poll results?
Yes.
Okay, so I think we could go ahead and do that and wrap up the meeting. You know, in case, yeah, let's just do that.
No, that sounds great. Linda, are you able to see the polls as well?
Yes. Did you want me to go over them?
Yeah, sure, maybe. I mean, I think,
okay.
I don't want to skew anything on my end.
So for the first question, which style furniture do you prefer? It was actually split evenly between the three options. So I don't think there's a strong preference for one of the furniture styles. I think what we'll do is we'll try to do some more outreach and see if there is a preference that emerges. I'm happy to see that there are three good options to choose from. And then for the second question, which aesthetic do you prefer for the agility equipment? Traditional, about half of the votes were for traditional, a third of the votes were for contemporary, and then naturalistic came in last. So it looks like traditional is slightly more preferred. Okay, well, thank you everyone for attending and participating. We'll post the presentation. Feel free to reach out to me. Also, for any project updates, we'll continue to post to the project website. Okay, thank you. Have a good night.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, everyone. Bye. Thank you.